Dear viewers, in this world of hiring and firing, the most important thing one wants to know is, what is HR all about? And to speak about how to get employed and how to actually stay in employment and how to not get out of it, I think it's better for me to speak to somebody who is a specialist in the field of HR. I have with me today Mrs. Hema Ravichander. Warm welcome to the show.
Thank you, Deepak.
Your claim to fame has been your association with Infosys.
Well, I think I'm a career HR professional.
Okay.
When I did my graduation and came out of the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad,
okay,
I was very clear that I was going to get into the field of HR.
Mm.
So I worked for 10 years in the engineering field in Michael Bosch.
Okay.
And then when IT was really opening up, the services sector was opening up in this country.
It was a challenge.
I joined Infosys in 1992.
Okay.
And in two stints, I was at Infosys until 2005.
Okay. And when you started, they just had about 350 people.
Yeah. I think in 92, we were about 250 Infoseons.
Okay.
When I left in 2005, okay, the employee strength was close to 40,000.
And you were the head of HR.
Yes, I was the global head of HR and the group head of HR.
Okay, but now you are an HR strategist, aren't you?
Yeah. So HR is my passion.
Okay.
And I always wanted to work pan-industry,
okay,
in the field of HR.
But what do you understand by HR? Because most people understand HR as employing people and keeping them in the job.
Simply put, that is it.
Okay.
But I think the human capital framework, if you look at it,
okay,
goes all the way from identifying your strategies,
okay,
in going to market,
okay,
to hire the right talent,
okay,
getting the right people in,
okay,
okay, rather than just an existing knowledge base,
okay,
grooming them, okay, helping them assimilate into the organization culture,
mm,
developing them depending on the role requirements and the competencies that are required for the role,
okay,
evaluating their performance, of course,
okay,
and seeing that the best get better increments, okay, and rewards. So the whole compensation and benefit administration space.
Okay.
And finally, of course, ensuring that the employee, mm, remains motivated and engaged. Because if you are engaged, you bring a little bit more of yourself, mm, to the workplace and you are much more productive.
You've really been in it. You exactly know what it is. Yeah. But to be able to employ somebody, that's the biggest challenge, to get the right people. What does a company look for? I mean, is it that, like you said, the learning abilities, or somebody who can assimilate, or somebody who can stay on, or somebody who can share the values? Like somebody said, the most important thing is when somebody comes into your company, whether the person can add values, if not anything else, if somebody can really be with you because he too or she too has the same set of values like you have, so that it becomes less stressful to get that person to think like you.
Right. It's all of that, Deepak, mm, and I think you put it very well. It is very important to identify the roles that you have in the organization.
Mm.
Identify what are the knowledge, skills, and attitudes,
mm,
that you need to perform those roles well.
Mm.
Overall, it means the competencies that are required.
Okay.
And then hire to those competencies.
Okay.
In the right number. That's where manpower planning comes into play.
Okay.
So you need to know that a particular role requires these functional competencies,
mm,
these behavioral competencies,
mm,
and of course adherence or alignment,
mm,
with the corporate value system,
mm,
that the organization has.
Okay.
And it is to this that you should hire.
Okay,
but in the right number. Because if you don't do it in the right number,
yes,
you will become knee-jerk in your reactions.
Yeah.
So the quality of hire and the quantity of hire,
yeah,
are
but
both
that
critical.
Is the problem with these macro organizations, right? And when you look at very small organizations, it's a very different thing. But at a very macro level, you'll have to look at leadership, delegation, deputation, and also division of labor, and a lot of things. And that manpower management itself becomes a different science altogether.
Yes.
Because it's not just looking at a person as an individual, but you're also looking at units, you're looking at groups, you're looking at departments, and don't you think that it's a very complicated science, because you're actually dealing with...
Actually, you can break it down, because in a startup, there is a particular profile of person that you need. You need somebody who is willing to very heavily multitask, who is able to not work within the organizational or job role boundaries, who has to have the tolerance for a lot of ambiguity and uncertainty. Whereas as you get more mature in the organization style, the roles get more clearly defined.
Okay.
The specializations get more clearly articulated.
Okay.
And again, you need to hire on that. So the principles is the same.
Okay.
But what people forget is that they don't usually break the roles into desired competencies and then hire against that.
But is it actually better for a company to grow up organically than, you know, sometimes you just absorb a company and suddenly recruit thousands of people and then you start re-engineering things to make it look like an organization? Because you're talking about this great example called Infosys itself.
See,
it's always grown out of a need-based environment.
See, I strongly believe HR philosophy has to align closely with the business philosophy.
Okay.
So HR has to enable the business to do what is right for the business.
Okay.
If the business growth is an organic one, then the HR systems and the capital framework have to be geared to growing from within.
Okay.
But if the HR business philosophy is very strongly inorganic, both can be expansive, expansionist, but if it is inorganic, then you have to have policies which help you identify the culture of one organization, identify the culture of the other organization, what are the gaps in the policies, in the culture, in the procedures, and then help integrate so that you don't end up at the end of the acquisition losing your key talent, which is people.
Okay.
So the HR policies have to align with the business policies.
Is that why nowadays people think the policy is the most important thing, and if at all you put your policy in place, then most of the other things also fall in place? Because
policy is important.
If you don't have a proper policy, that you could lose focus. And you know, because that is the broader framework within which you can work. Because what happens is what kind of people you want, how much you want, why you want, and whether you can actually keep them. That's the most important question these days that people are asking.
Yeah. So you have the business philosophy. Flowing out of that, you will have your HR philosophy. Flowing out of your HR philosophy, you'll have your HR policies. So policies are very critical.
Okay.
But policies are nothing if they are not implemented well, which is your HR processes.
Okay.
So I personally think there is a lot of devil in the detail.
Okay.
So you have the policy, you need to have the right process with which the policy is deployed.
Implementable.
And the best policy, if deployed poorly, makes for a very, very poor
HR philosophy. But is it actually possible that, you know, that a lot of companies can have similar HR philosophies but can have different HR policies? And sometimes, you know, these HR policies themselves could be obstacles in the process of a smooth running of an organization, because, you know, sometimes it could be a little arbitrary, sometimes, you know, it could be thought of as a knee-jerk reaction to a certain development, sometimes it could be a certain person's idea which may not be actually as scientific or well thought of as it's supposed to be.
Yes, I think it is important to have a consistent deployment of your philosophy and your policies. Now obviously there are certain times when what you had planned will have to be re-engineered, because organizations have to be nimble.
Okay.
And if the business is getting re-engineered in some some sense, there's no point in keeping your HR without those changes. But when you do these changes, I think it's important to be very fair about it, as transparent as possible about it.
Okay.
Explain to employees the rationale of doing it.
Okay.
And if we have made a mistake, acknowledge the mistake, and in future cycles of such implementation, implement the learnings.
Okay.
If by and large your core HR deployment okay. follows these kind of key tenets or principles,
okay.
I think it is a mature organization.
But how is it actually possible to organize a very large number of people under one roof in one company when people may actually come with certain skill sets and that's the commonality, but when it comes to, you know, such varied interests and attitudes and aspirations, and because I was even recently speaking to a few people who are talking about, you know, they really want to know the aspiration level of an employee who wants to be recruited, and whether, you know, money is the most important thing, growth is the most important thing, and whether the company really wants that kind of a person to come in. So do you think that, you know, isn't it some kind of a burden on the company to be constantly, you know, watching the employees in terms of, you know, because they are also constantly changing, because it's like we're talking about a nimble organization, but at the same time, it's constantly, what do you say, a changing mindset too, with the kind of things that are happening around the world and with the changing demands as well as the pressures in the society.
Deepak, that-
Okay.
And human beings are.
But it's not like in the government organizations, like, you know, I mean, you had some set of people and, you know, they just joined and, you know, lived for some time or worked and, you know, ultimately retired. But here, like, you people become, particularly in IT industry, people are the wealth. So
I think it's very important, and that is the challenge and the beauty of it, to be able to understand the aspirations of individuals, because as we said in the beginning, if you understand the aspirations, then you are able to, you know, address those aspirations through allocating people to the right role,
okay.
giving them the right motivational tools, ensuring that they are engaged. Because if they are not engaged, their productivity levels can seriously suffer.
Okay.
The other thing is that in a market where there is a lot of war for talent, if you don't do this, okay, and if you don't do this, then talent will flow to where their needs are best met. And I'm not just talking financial needs.
Okay.
I'm talking about the learning needs.
Okay.
I'm talking about their emotional connect needs.
Okay.
I'm talking about their wanting to be part of a larger society. There are people who want to work in sustainable organizations, in green organizations, whatever it is.
Okay.
So you have to identify the anchors of these individuals and address that.
Okay.
I think we have moved away from a system where you had lifetime employment to being able to provide people lifetime employability.
Okay.
If you really want to engage with
them.
Even if you take the defense services today,
yeah.
there's no longer lifetime employment.
Yes.
Everybody wants to take a short service commission and come out and do something else which will keep him or her employable in a better way.
When you need to reallocate a certain responsibility or re-engage somebody from something that he or she is already doing, don't you think that we cannot just take somebody for granted that somebody is actually as willing as we expect them to be?
Right.
Because I was listening to somebody talking about, you know, new job that comes in, and you know, you really look for who is most competent to be put in that job, and you just look for the kind of competencies or the kind of talent that's available, and then you assign them to this job. But that is also a little risky, isn't it? Because though the company may know that it already has that kind of resources, but then it's almost like, because when we can't even move out of a house, or, you know, move out of a habit, but when somebody is already ensconced in a very comfortable position and is looking for at least continuing in that, the company is really playing with their capabilities itself.
Yeah, there is an element of risk when a person who is very happy in a current role is being put into a new role.
For the benefit of the company, ultimately.
Which has a stretch target.
Okay.
But I think organizations must work for a win-win.
Okay.
And successful organizations will be able to identify what's in it for the individual who is moving into that role.
So motivation.
It's motivation.
It can be incentive.
It can be career growth. It can be global skills.
Okay.
For example, let's take a person who's very, very comfortable handling the Indian market.
Okay.
And you're saying, now move out of this Indian market and go and...
Because you know that's good for him.
And for the organization.
Yeah.
Because you want somebody
with that
skills.
But whether he accepts it or not, whether he's ready. But then you're constantly in conflict with that person, right?
Not necessarily. Not necessarily. And I think great managers know the pulse of their employees. They know when their employees, and you know, very high achievement oriented individuals also want constantly new targets.
So it's painstaking as well as time consuming, isn't it? HR is not an easy job.
See, HR, and that's another thing, Deepak, the best HR managers are your first line managers. That is the employee's own manager in his or her function is the best HR manager.
Okay.
A HR department or a HR function in an organization does its work greatly when it helps design policies and processes for this first line manager to use appropriately to develop his or her team.
Which is very pervasive rather, which is like implementable at every level.
Yeah.
It is not that one organization, there is one department and everybody needs to approach that department.
Right.
So it's okay.
So you know, there is this famous saying that an army moves on its belly.
Okay.
So when the army used to move, you had to ensure that the food, the canteen, all of those things were very well set in place.
Okay.
Similarly, in these organizations, the organizations move on the belly of the first line manager.
Okay.
He or she must be empowered with knowledge about the HR policies, with support should he require HR department's help, with training to be a great people manager. Given by HR departments, so that he or she
with a little
is a
bit
great
of discretion
line
also.
Manager. Yes, there is counseling skills, there is discretionary skills, there's confidentiality, there's how to handle meetings, there's how to motivate, how to differentiate the best from the rest, how to give hard and negative feedback.
Okay.
All these are not easy skills to come by.
Okay, now it really explains how a company like Infosys can survive so well. Because I think that
I think
it's
large
extremely
organizations
important.
Are mature in the way they handle
this. Now you say that, you know, I mean, there's a very standard acceptable HR mechanism that is in place in most of the large companies, is it?
Yes.
Or are they really trying to find the best?
See, as business changes, as environment changes, there are situations which require changes in policies.
Okay. Particularly in this time of recession, where people have to be removed from their jobs or have to be fired or have to be asked to, you know, to be put in places where they could
so I think it starts
themselves.
All the way from the beginning.
Okay.
You have
but is that the biggest task where, you know, I mean, to handle the emotion of an employee, particularly when
it's
you need to communicate
tasks.
Something.
It's one of the tasks, a very important task.
Okay.
But I'll go a couple of steps backwards and talk through what are the stages.
Okay.
I think we have to plan in recruiting the right numbers.
Okay.
Because if you
Instead of actually, ultimately,
then you have a problem. And you have to be ready to change the plans and be able to adapt very, very quickly, almost just in time hiring.
Okay. Forget about the people who plan to leave the company. What about people who come to actually stay? Because, you know, when you recruit a person, the person may have actually come in with a lot of dreams and aspirations and plans for his life also. And then after a while, because if you've actually taken the person in the first place, that only means that, you know, you're given a promise of a job. And you also offered that I'm going to train you, I'm going to take care of you, I'm going to groom you, I'm going to mentor you, I'm going to teach you everything. But then the person comes and works for a while and then you find the person is not actually matching up to what you require. Are.
That's
then
the
you,
greatest sorrow, you
then
know.
Then isn't it your mistake as an HR person?
Yeah. I would think you didn't hire right.
Yeah.
You didn't hire right.
Okay.
Not just HR. Because you see, again, as I said, it's a partnership between HR and the employee's line manager.
Okay.
But you didn't really know what you were looking for.
Okay.
And you got somebody who was really not fitting the role.
Okay.
So you spent so much of time, resources, energy in ensuring that you got the right person, hopefully the right person in. I think organizations and therefore the HR mandate is to help these individuals settle in well. So you have very strong, you should have very strong orientation programs, induction programs.
But is there enough space to amble around, to actually try things out before you actually come to a conclusion as to whether you can retain a person or throw the person out? Or is it like, you know, I mean, there is a point of no return where you really know that, you know, nothing much can be done. Because you have many mechanisms, particularly you're talking about training, grooming, talking, counseling, everything.
Yeah.
And is that, you know, like somewhere you actually have to make a decision that this is not the person whom we wanted to hire
it
in the first place?
It again depends on the times, but in the ideal scenario, a person is not meeting your requirements for one of two reasons. Either he or she is poor on competence, or he or she is poor on your attitude.
Okay. Or is not willing to learn?
That's the attitude.
Okay.
It's an attitude, right? So there is an attitude mismatch.
But how often attitude changes in an employee? I'm sure it changes quite often, but you know, sometimes there are these compulsions also, at least whether their external attitude is different within the company, they need to keep the professional attitude intact. But does the professional attitude also keep changing in some people?
See, if a person is motivated, he has a particular attitude. Conditions change, or he perceives them as changing.
Okay.
He reacts.
Okay.
His attitude can change.
Perhaps the person becomes very successful in the job and suddenly there are offers from elsewhere, you know, that also can result in a change of his attitude.
Yeah, it depends on what his anchor is, if it is money, if it is an overseas posting, and you can't meet those, and you've not discussed that and given him an alternate option which is exciting in the organization, you can lose him. So if it is, going back to the earlier point, if it is performance, then you have to sit with him and help him improve his performance by either rechanging his role or by giving him more training or by giving him a mentor who can help him get to his job. If it is attitude, then you have to give feedback again, saying, friend, this is not the way we should be aligning.
Okay, but now, most often attitude becomes the biggest problem.
No, it could be either. Principal has hit.
Okay.
And they may have a role in some other place in the organization. Okay. So you really want to retain them. They are organizational people. It's just that you fitted a wrong set of competencies into another place. So if something else opens up, great for that. And I know many success cases. So if it is performance, if it is attitude, you need to address it. And then you need to give some time when he or she is able to do that. And then do a dipstick and a check. And if that things are not improving, then you should say, friend, I think we are in the wrong path and maybe we shouldn't be walking this path together.
But you started off with engineering, then went into IT. Now we're actually working with different kinds of fields and organizations. But in this particular scene, when people are talking about people losing jobs, is it as bad as it appears to be? Or is it just some kind of a psychosis?
I think different industries have faced this with different levels of impact. So there is no as bad, it is all relative.
Okay.
If you take some industries, there is growth. If you take some industries, they've had to change their performance benchmark.
Okay.
So if they said the bottom 2% would have to step out.
Okay.
Today it may be the bottom 5% or the bottom 10%, you know, because they're tightening their belts. Or there may be, you know, situations where they're just reducing
but
the number of jobs.
But they're not actually foresee all these things, because in any business there are ups and downs. And how is it possible that a sound organization that is even grown to that level could have just overlooked a possibility of a recession?
And then, the business, you know, changes of last year.
But then what about people who have actually depended on the job and where you really need to, you know, tighten your belt and shed fat and
which is why I think it's as much the onus of the employee as it is of the employer to remain career resilient.
Okay. And to adapt also.
And what I mean by this is that many times there is a belief that I have joined an organization. It's the organization's responsibility to help me develop as a professional and as an individual. I think that time is gone.
Okay.
The onus really should be the employees.
Okay.
Of course, partnered by mature and progressive organizations, saying that if I need to stay relevant in a changing economic situation, in the new kind of geographic expansion that my company is undertaking, in the types of diversification that my company is undertaking, what do I need to do? And there are various things. You can build your knowledge by doing reading. You can build your skills by picking up certain things that you want to do. For example, volunteering proactively for certain roles. And you can also ask people within and outside the organization to be your coaches and mentors. Because I think if employees are going to sit passively saying, here is me, now develop me, they're putting themselves at risk. It is as much the onus of the individual as it is of the organization. And if you are not career resilient, given the way dynamically the environment is changing, you can end up being a dinosaur.
Okay, but what you're trying to say is that if you're career resilient, that even in a situation like this, you could still survive in a job and still do better.
See,
it's not the wait for fate to take its course on you.
There is this famous saying,
then
whatever the crowd, when the elephant walks, there is a path carved out for him or her.
Yes.
Right?
Okay.
So in the same way, if you are jolly good in what you do.
Yeah, yeah.
And you bring talent and skills to the table which the company requires.
Okay. Even if all are to leave, you still would remain there.
Yeah. Or not even not in that organization, somewhere else. Or, you know, they say this about, you know, artists.
Mm.
They have to really have their portfolio and they carry that everywhere.
Okay.
In a sense, all of us are individual contributors.
Okay.
And if we don't look at our own resume ability.
Okay.
You know, there's this famous Tom Peters quotation or anecdote which goes like this. Somebody is laying off an employee.
Mm.
And somebody else says, my God, what a waste. He's being laid off.
Mm.
It's 10 years of experience going waste.
Mm.
So the other person says, is it 10 years of experience or 1 year of experience multiplied 10 times? That is the aspect of resume ability.
Okay.
You have to enrich your own resume. And as times become challenging, as the environment becomes competitive, as there are more employees in the market than employers in many cases, if you don't do this, you do this at your own peril. So I think career resilience is a very strong onus of the employee.
But is it actually true, like in the old economy, there was this belief, I don't know whether it's actually intact still in the new economy or the new businesses, that there is no emotion in business. But particularly when it comes to HR, even when you talk to somebody, try to understand, is there an element of emotion? Or if you really think that things don't work out, it doesn't matter, however good the person is, you need to shed it.
I think the Indian workplace is all about emotion.
Yeah.
I would say, in certain cultures and economies, there's a very strong desire to keep personal away from professional.
Okay.
But my belief is, if you're working in the Indian environment, welcome to the world
of emotion,
where employees bring their personal problems to work.
Okay.
They expect you to listen. They expect you, if possible, to empathize.
Yeah, yeah.
And if possible, bring in a solution.
Okay, but
now,
is it actually a burden? Is it actually a liability? Is it a hindrance? Does it actually create problems for somebody in the smooth functioning of an organization? Or is it actually better to understand that emotional quotient, if it's at a higher level, that you can actually get people to perform better?
There's more commitment and loyalty. It depends on how you look at it. The way I see it. Is that once you are connected with the employee at that level, it is very difficult to break the link of employer-employee.
Okay.
Because if you are connecting with the employee only on the plane of the financials or on a compensation platform, any new kid on the block, any new company on the block, by paying X percent more can break that link.
Okay.
Whereas if you are connecting with the employee in a larger context of being there for him in enabling his professional space and also empathizing with some of his other issues, the connect is much more powerful.
Okay.
And that is where organizations retain employees.
But if an employee starts draining the emotional resources of the company instead of actually contributing in return in terms of productivity, does it actually become a problem there?
Obviously,
the you are ready to listen to the person, and the person always comes up with a problem for you to listen to.
So organizations have various ways of doing it.
Okay.
Your line manager is only the first level of counseling.
Okay.
It's good for him to have counseling skills. There is in-house HR departments.
Okay.
There are external counselors which organizations tie up with.
Okay.
In fact, many organizations today have hotline counseling lines.
Okay.
Where when people, because you see, as you realize, people are moving, there's urbanization happening.
Okay.
Nuclear family setups.
Okay.
People are having strong social burdens, having to look after dependent relations, extended families, but nuclear in where they are staying.
Mm.
There is a lot of stress and trauma in the current competitive world.
Okay.
It is good for people to be able to reach out and speak to people. Organizations realize that they don't have internal resources, but the connect is there. Because you know, that's why I said you must listen, you must empathize, you must provide avenues where he or she can address some of those problems.
Okay. But compared to the kind of workforce that's available anywhere else in the world, how do you rate the employability of an Indian in an Indian company?
See, there's a lot of research coming out saying that, unfortunately, the employability percentage of many, many of our 450,000, 500,000 engineers is very low.
Okay.
And that is, I think, a cause for concern.
Okay.
Because in the boom times, and I'm again going back 2 years ago,
okay,
you had 400,000, 450,000 engineers coming out.
Okay.
But everybody was running behind the tier one, tier two.
Okay.
And there were so many who were still grossly unemployed.
Okay.
Right? So I think there is a big challenge for India Inc.
Okay.
At a macro level to improve the employability quotient, not just for the engineering graduates, but also for the bachelors of arts, science, etc., which is feeding several other industries, whether it's retail, whether it's the IT-enabled services, etc. Also, what about, you know, the quality education? What number of PhDs coming out is abysmally low. What about the number of pharmacists that are required? There are a whole set of space, and there again, the potential of the person to have the employability factor. Many other countries are scoring higher than us on this employability quotient.
Okay.
And this is something we need to address at a macro level, definitely.
But otherwise, things are quite okay for the world, as far as the Indian is concerned.
Yes, I mean, it's. I think we bring a lot of fire to succeed.
Okay.
There is a burning desire to succeed.
Okay.
In fact, if you take any average Indian household, the parents are fully behind and involved in the class 10 preparations, the class 12 preparations, the study preparations. I think that's great for India Inc. There is a burning zeal, as I said, to succeed. We are very quick to adapt to our changing environments.
Okay.
We have great tolerance for uncertainty because we thrive in that.
And insult too.
And we have to pick up certain cross-cultural skills.
Okay.
But there are certain things that we need to develop when we work globally, which is, I think, we need to become more assertive.
Okay.
Second, we need to speak up.
Okay.
Third, we need to give the bad news ahead rather than when the rubber hits the road, you know. Fourth is, on an appraisal dimension, we should start getting to a stage where we are much more comfortable managing for results than just for effort. You see, we tend to say the person is very hard working.
Okay.
He's here with me 12 hours of the day.
Okay, but what is the output?
So these are certain skills that I think we need to start developing as a community, because that is the real professional world.
It was extremely interesting speaking about all these things, Hema, because at a time like this, you know, when a lot of people have great concerns about how the things are going to be in the future and how to keep their jobs and how to be employed at all, it was really very reassuring. Thank you very much for
having me. I must do one little PR pitch for HR.
Okay.
Because HR is such an exciting area. And I'm really not happy at the numbers of people coming out from colleges and top-tier institutions specializing in HR.
Okay.
I really believe that is also an area which we must actively look at.
Okay. And there's so much scope and
because
growth. And
there is alignment with business.
Yes.
There is adapting policies to business.
And you're a great example.
Individual people's lives. And hoping that, you know, you make a better company, a better individual, and of course a better India.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deepak. Great being here.